Okay, so this is the last meeting of this class. So today I will tell you about Chan Simons gauge theory. So we'll be considering a three-dimensional manifold. And then we assume that there is a vector bundle. Over this manifold. And then there is a connection A. The one form. And there is a gauge group G acting on it. So A takes value in the adjoint representation of the group G. The Chan-Simons theory, oh, by the way, so if F, A is a connection one form, F given by dA plus A wedge A is giving you the curvature. Or physicist terminology, field strength. Of this vector bundle. So, if you have a connection, that means that you can actually parallel transport the element of over each point on the manifold, there is a vector space. So you can pick a vector, an element of that particular vector space, the fiber over a given point. And if you have a connection, you can parallel transport that vector along a path on M. If you take a closed path, that vector may not come back to the same point, same vector element. And this field strength tells you the amount of that curvature. The Chan-Simons actions is defined to be given by this combination. Or if I write in terms of components, so let me first explain the notation. So A is one form, so dA is two form, ADA is three form, A cube is also three form. But value in the are valued in the adjoint representation, so I take a trace to give you a genuine one form taking value in the real number. So you can integrate that over three-dimensional manifold if there is orientation. So I assume that M is oriented. So you can integrate that over the three manifold. Well, if I write in terms of component, coordinate component, if I introduce coordinate, and if I write in terms of component, you can also write this as in this way. So here I wrote this commutator explicitly. Okay, and trace is over fundamental representation of this group G. So A takes value in the adjoint representation. So that means that it is a matrix acting on the fundamental representation. So I take trace in the space of fundamental representation. Okay, so this action has a particular property that if I take variation of this Chan-Simons action with respect to the gauge field A mu, then you get something that is proportional to the field strength. So the equation of motion for this action means that implies that the connection is flat. Now, K is some real number. And you can think of this as inverse of coupling constant. If gauge group G is simple and compact, such as the case of SU2, for example, or SUN, then K has to be integer with respect to that normalization there. And this is required by gauge invariance. So here is a question number one. Show that S. Chan-Simon is invariant under infinitesimal gauge transformation. That is, that A mu, if A transforms into A plus capital D of lambda, where lambda is some adjoint value scalar function, and D of lambda is equal to D of lambda plus A commutator lambda, namely the covariant derivative of lambda. So this is a Noetherian version of infinitesimal gauge transformation. I'd like you to show that this action is invariant under this infinitesimal transformation. This works. Since this is an infinitesimal transformation, this condition is not required. It's a straightforward algebraic exercise to show that it is invariant. It's actually very straightforward. You just have to use this identity, in fact, and plus the Bianchi identity for the curvature form, to form F, then you can prove that this Chan-Simon action is indeed invariant. So that's good, because that means that the action makes sense independently of the choice of the trivialization of the vector bundle. So it's a genuine function on the choice of the vector bundle. But there is a trick here, that is that if G is simple and compact, what happens is that actually pi 3 of G is non-trivial. So pi 3 of G being non-trivial means that there can be non-trivial map from 3 manifold into the space of a gauge group. So that means that there can be gauge transformation which may not be continuously connected to the trivial gauge transformation. If this was trivial, then you can sort of perform any gauge transformation. Any gauge transformation can be continuously connected to a trivial gauge transformation. So it's almost sufficient to show that action is invariant under infinitesimal gauge transformation. That would imply almost automatically that action is gauge invariant, period. However, if this is non-trivial, that means that this is not sufficient to guarantee that action is gauge invariant, because there can be topologically non-trivial gauge transformation which cannot be continuously connected to a trivial gauge transformation. This leads to this quantization condition, that this is a condition that is needed in order for the action to be invariant, even for topologically non-trivial transformation represented by the non-trivial element of pi 3. Okay, so in any way, if this G is simple and compact, and if I choose K to be integer, then this action right here is a well-defined object. So we can use that to define quantum field theory. And this is an interesting quantum field theory, because we do not need a metric to write down this action. Usually, when we write down the action, we need to use a metric. For example, in the case of scalar action, where we have dx to the n if it is n-dimensional squares, and then we have to use metric to write down even kinetic term like that. So So that means that in order to write down the action for scalar field, we don't not only need differentiable structure on the manifold, but we need a Riemannian structure of the manifold. So therefore, the resulting quantum field theory knows about the choice of the metric. If you choose different metric, in general, the value of observable evaluated by functional integral or whatever the method you use to quantize the system, that would depend on the choice of the metric. Here, the action does not explicitly depend on the metric. So, one can expect that if the quantization can be carried out without introducing any Riemannian structure, then the resulting observable depends only on the differentiable structure of the manifold and not the Riemannian structure. So, namely, that observable will be topologically invariant. Of course, this is something that is not completely obvious because, after all, we are dealing with quantum field theory. So there are subtleties such as ultraviolet divergences that need to be regularized and renormalized. So we need to ensure that that process does not secretly bring in dependence on the metric, because sometimes in order to regularize it, you may have to introduce metric, for example. Fortunately, in the case of Chan-Simons theory, since the ultraviolet divergence is sufficiently mild, because we don't have so many derivatives in the Lagrangian, so it turns out that you can carry out this process of regularization and renormalization. In fact, it is almost a finite theory, so we don't even have to worry about renormalization, although there is a slight effect of renormalization. Anyway, that can be dealt with without introducing a metric. So in the end, this observable of the theory turned out to be still respecting this topological invariance. Okay, so today I would like to tell you a little bit about, so since we only have an hour and more, like 15 minutes left, so I cannot give you the full detail of the Chan-Simon theory, but I would like to give you a glimpse of Chan-Simon theory. So I would like to start with a very simple example of abelian theory. So in this case, the gauge group G is U1. So in this case, actually, the pi 3 of this G is trivial, so we don't have to worry about topologically non-trivial gauge connection unless there is non-trivial pi 1 in the manifold. So we can, there is no quantization condition, in fact. For the U1 gauge theory, the Chan-Simon action is just this. ADA integrated over the manifold, and K is not quantized. So K can take value in real number. This is actually a very interesting theory. So for example, in condensed matter physics, there is a very interesting effect called fractional quantum Hall effect. And that low energy effective theory is described by this U1 Chan-Simon theory. And the reason for that is that we know that if you have fractional quantum Hall material which exhibit fractional quantum Hall effect, then there's actually no propagating degrees of freedom in the bulk. There are current flowing on the boundary of the system. And then you can ask, well, what kind of system? What are the, some kind of low energy effective actions that describe such a system? Well, so when we talk about low energy effective action, we try to write down operator with low mass dimension. In fact, action can be, so for example, if you have, in the case of standard gauge theory, for example, you start with Young-Mills action, F mu nu, because this is the first gauge invariant observable that you can write down, so let's maybe write it as F squared. There is actually another term you can write down in the case of four dimension, which is something like that. So sometimes we can include that. So that would be the first term that you'd write. So you'd write F squared with some gauge coupling constant. And then we introduce FHF with what is called theta term.
But so this will be the complete Lagrangian if you think of this as a sort of starting point of the system. But sometimes these appear as some kind of low energy effective action. So in which case there can be some further correction to that. For example, you can have a term like f to the cube, for example. That will be suppressed by something which has a dimension of mass square. So suppose you have some theory which is sort of approximately correct in low energy, but change it to some other more fundamental theory at energy scale m, then you can have low energy effective action which is expanded like that. But if you are considering the effect where the field strength is much smaller compared to the mass scale, we can ignore those things, because those are suppressed by the ratio of F over M. So that's why when we talk about low energy effective action, we look for terms with lowest number of derivatives. So therefore, for example, when we assume that low energy effective theory have degrees of freedom given by gauge field, then this will be the first term to write down, because this is gauge invariant Lagrangian density which has lowest derivative. That would be the case when we are talking about four-dimensional physics. But in three-dimensional, you can do something even better, because this one has only one derivative. So for example, F squared, so let me remind you that in the standard normalization, F field strength would have a dimension of mass squared. The reason for that is that this is a derivative operator. Derivative operator has dimension of inverse of length, which means that it has a dimension of mass. A is a covariant derivative. A appears in the covariant derivative. So that means that A must have the same dimension as the derivative. So that means that this combination has a dimension of mass square. So F square would have dimension of mass to the fourth, which is why actually the four-dimensional Maxwell theory is conformal invariant, because F square is dimension four operator, so you can integrate that over four dimension to get dimensionless number. But in three dimension, this still have dimension four, but this has dimension three. So this is actually much more important low energy, in low energy than this one. So you can expect that there can be some low energy system where the effect of this would dominate the effect of this one. And that is indeed, that is realized in the fractional quantum Hall effect. So that's one way to understand why the Chan-Simon action plays dominant role in describing the fractional quantum Hall effect. Now, as I wrote over there, the variation of the Chan-Simon action with respect to gauge field give rise to field strength. So that means that equation of motion, equations of motion is simply F mu nu is equal to zero. So since F mu is equal to zero, there is no local gauge invariant observable that you can write down. No local gauge invariant observable. Because any local gauge invariant observable you can write down would be combination of F or its derivatives and their product. So if F vanishes by equation motion, then there is no choice for that. However, there can be non-local observables, and one of the important class of observables are called Wilson loops. So I'm going over here. So let me remind you that we have a manifold M, and over this manifold we have a vector bundle. In this case, we are considering Abelian theory, so we have just a line bundle over it. But in general, we have a vector space over each point. And the connection one form is used to transport an element of the this vector space over here, say V. If you have a path gamma in the on the baseline called M, we can use this connection to send this V along this path to another vector V prime. Done in the following way that, so for example, in here we are considering the abelian theory. So in this case, it is particularly simple. So in this case, we just have a one dimensional vector bundle. And so suppose I have P, a point P on M, then over this we have a vector V. And suppose you have this path gamma to go to P prime. Then this is going to be parallel transported to V prime. And V prime will be given by exponential of I times Q times integral of A along gamma multiplied by V. This Q is specified by, so Q appears when you define the covariant derivative to this way. You can think of Q as a charge associated to this covariant derivative. So for example, if you use this covariant derivative for a kinetic term for matter field, then Q will be a charge of that particle. So you have this factor right here, which you need to multiply in order to parallel transport this vector V to V prime. Now, suppose I perform gauge transformation A mu into A mu plus del mu of lambda at each point. So this is question number two. Suppose I do that, then I would like you to show that this Wilson line operator, which is given by this, starting at P and ending at P prime, I'd like you to show that this would transform as e to the iq lambda of p prime w of gamma e to the minus iq lambda of p. I'd like you to show that if w is given by exponential of iq times integral of a from point p to point p prime, then such w would transform like that. This is good because we know that v has to transform into e to the iq lambda of p of v, and we know that v prime has to transform like that. So therefore, these three relations is consistent with this relation that V prime is related to V by multiplication of W, because this phase factor gets cancelled by this phase factor, and you acquire this additional phase factor which is consistent with this. So this W sort of interpolates between this transformation property and this transformation property. So in particular, suppose you have a closed loop. Suppose gamma start at point P and end at point P. So in that case, what happens is that W of gamma would be invariant because this phase factor would cancel with this phase factor. This will be the case in the abelian gauge theory that we are considering. In no abelian theory, what you have to do is that you just have to take trace over W, because in that case, W would be matrix. These would be matrix-valued transformation property. These would be an element of the gauge group G. But if you start with a point P and end at point P prime, this and this will be inverse to each other. So if you take trace, then the W would be gauge invariant. So this is called Wilson loop. Ken Wilson was a Caltech graduate student, and he came up with this observable as one of the fundamental observables in gauge theory. That in particular, he introduced this observable as some kind of order parameter to decide whether particular gauge theory in four dimensions is confining or not confining. Anyway, so in abelian case, this is it. Now, one interesting feature of this Wilson loop observable is what happens if you infinitesimally deform this loop. So you have this gamma, but suppose you infinitesimally deform this loop like that. Now, this kind of infinitesimal deformation of the loop can always be thought of as addition of a small loop in the following sense. Suppose you have a loop like that. And suppose you decide that instead of going this way, you infinitesimally deform this loop like that. Then what you can do is the following. Suppose instead of just bumping the loop like that, so let me put the orientation here, so it's going to be going this way. Instead of putting some bump over here, what I can do is to decide to go this way and then come back, and then go in this way. Well, what happens is that here you have this phase factor, e to the integral of a. But suppose I go once this way and come back, then phase factor between here and here would cancel out. So, therefore, creating a bump like that is the same as adding a small infinitesimal loop like that. And in particular, abelian case, since Wilson loop, Wilson line observable, is always some complex number, so it's just a multiplication of Wilson loop for this gamma, and then another Wilson loop for this small infinitesimal loop. So, Wilson loop for this loop is equal to the Wilson loop for the original loop times Wilson loop for this small bump. This is gamma and this is epsilon. So what is this W of epsilon? Well, W of epsilon is an exponential of integral of A over this small loop epsilon. But we know that integral of, suppose you have a region like that, and then suppose you integrate A in this region, well, by the Stokes theorem, this is the same as surface integral of field strength over the disk that is bounded by this epsilon. So therefore, we see that if you have Wilson loop observable, and if you suppose you start with Wilson loop observable over given loop gamma, but suppose you decide to infinitesimally deform it by adding some loop epsilon, then what happens is that this is the same as Wilson loop over the original gamma, but is multiplied by exponential of integral of field strength over disk that is bounded by this epsilon. But equation motion says that F vanishes. And since we are considering the Abelian theory, in the case of Abelian theory, it's a Gaussian theory, so we can always use the equation of motion. So that means that this factor is actually trivial. So that means that when you evaluate the Wilson line expectation value, the value is invariant under infinitesimal deformation. So you can infinitesimally deform the Wilson line observable, and the result of the evaluation of functional integral would not change. And that's what it should be when we are considering topological invariant theory, because deforming the loop infinitesimally is a topologically invariant, topologically trivial deformation. However, there are cases where we cannot perform such infinitesimal deformation. Suppose, for example, we have two Wilson loops which are linked like this. You can of course always infinitesimally deform this link like that. That is totally legitimate, and you would expect that expectation value of the Wilson loops for these two links will not change under such infinitesimal deformation. But you cannot deform this into unlink. This is not possible. So there will be a difference between the expectation value for these Wilson loops and for this Wilson loop. And in fact, we can see that. You can show that suppose you have such two links, gamma 1 and gamma 2, which are sort of linked in three dimensions in a topologically non-trivial way, then you can show that expectation value of link Wilson loop over gamma 1 with charge Q1 and Wilson loop with for gamma 2 with charge Q2. And if we normalize it by the single expectation value of each individual loops, by this symbol expectation value, what I mean is a functional integral with this Wilson loop included with the Chan-Simon action. So this is what I mean by this expectation value. You can evaluate this. You can evaluate this and show that this is equal to exponential of 2 pi I over k times q1 times q2 times, actually, maybe this is I over 2. So we can, well, maybe it's better to write it in this way. 2 pi I, excuse me, over k of q1 times q2 times phi of gamma 1 times gamma 2, where this phi of gamma 1, gamma 2 is given by the following formula. This is a formula that you might have seen in the context of, say, Biot-Savart formula in the electromagnetism. It's very similar to that. So this quantity is called Gauss linking number. So what this means is the following, that so Gauss linking number is a foreign quantity. So for example, if you look at this two loops like that, and if you project that on the two-dimensional plane like I'm doing here on the blackboard, then you see that there are two crossings here. Gaussian linking number is basically the number that counts the number of crossing. But however, in order for this Gaussian linking number to be topologically invariant, one has to distinguish the orientation of the linking. So for example, this is a trivial link. We know that this will also be a trivial link. Because we can slide this off like that. And what you can do in that case is, well, even though you have two links, but you see that you can define the orientation appropriately so that this and this would come with opposite sign. So this can be assigned with plus one, and this can be assigned with minus one, because, so for example, this is, if you look at this, this is going, well, this is going underneath and this is going over it. And the line which is going from left to right is going underneath of the line from here to here. Here it is going in the opposite way, so you can think of this and this having opposite orientation. On the other hand, if they are linked like this, then the topological configuration of these two lines are identical in these two. So you can assign plus one for both of these and plus one minus one for both for these. So Gaussian linking number for this one is zero and that for this one is two, actually. So this is one of the topological invariants, so this is consistent with the expectation that the Chan-Simon path integral should give you topological invariant. So that would be the case for abelian theory. So in abelian theory, therefore, basically the Wilson loop correlation function gives you this classical topological invariant for the loops, links, and the knots. Now, situation in non-abelian theory is interesting. Because this is going to give you more modern topological invariant that developed by Bon-Jones and others. Suppose now G is non-abelian. Well, in that case, first of all, the Chan-Simon action now takes this form. So this is highly non-trivial because now we are talking about interacting quantum field theory. It's not no more Gaussian. So you can expect it more interesting. And we can still consider Wilson loop expectation value. So we can still consider Wilson line operator integral of a connection over some path gamma. But here we have to be careful about definition of this exponential because A's at different points do not commute with each other anymore because this is the matrix value. So in order to make sense of this, what we do is basically when we have exponential, you define it as sum over n factorial of I integral of A gamma to the n. But then we introduce this symbol called P of exponential. What I mean by that is that Well, if you sort of expand this into n factors, we have integral of A over gamma, right? And so we can write this as sort of integral of dx1, dx2, etc., dxn, of A of x1, A of xn, etc. And then when I put P over here, what I mean is that A's with x, so we have a loop here. So if you have a beginning point and end point, there is ordering of the point along this path. So what this symbol P means is that these fields A are ordered according to the order of the point over here. So this symbol P is called path ordering. And in fact, if you follow the definition of the connection, and if you ask, suppose, for example, you have a manifold M, and suppose you have a path along the path gamma along the manifold, and ask how a vector over a given point P gets parallel transported to another vector over point P prime, then now, since we are talking about an abelian theory, the transportation from of V to V prime is done by some matrix. And if you pass order this exponential, then the resulting combination gives you precisely this required matrix. So this is the correct ordering operator. And in general, of course, when we consider non-abelian theory, this vector V will be various different representation of non-abelian gauge, non-abelian group G. So previously, when we talk about abelian Chan-Simon theory, there was a charge Q that was introduced in defining the Wilson loop. Here, instead of doing that, I have to decide what kind of representation that we choose for the non-abelian group G, and A would be taking value in that particular representation. And then if you have a closed loop, what we can do is to define Wilson loop operator for a given representation of group G and the choice of gamma as trace over that representation of path ordered exponential of the connection A. So that would be the Wilson loop operator for the gauge theory. In the case when the gauge group G is SU2 and when R is the fundamental representation, the expectation value of the Wilson loop gives you what is called, what is now called Jones polynomial invariance of knot and links. And if you consider more general representation or more general simple and compact group G, then you'd get a generalization of this Jones invariant. Okay? So that'd be sort of formal definition of Chan-Simon theory and its Wilson loop observer. Now we can always try to define, try to compute the expectation value of W using functional integral, but it is often convenient and useful to have different perspective in quantization, and in physics, it is very often very useful to combine two different approaches for quantization. One is a functional integral approach that you just try to make sense of integrating over all possible, in this case, configuration of the gauge field. But there is an alternative point of view, which is called canonical quantization. So I'd like to discuss that, and I'd like to combine that to give you some new perspective in computing Chan-Simon invalid. Okay? So in canonical quantization, what we do is that instead of considering functional integral over arbitrary three-dimensional space, we consider first three-dimensional space to be combination of some time direction times two-dimensional surface. So this is time direction. So then we try to consider Hilbert space associated to given space-like slice, in this case gamma. So there will be a Hilbert space on this gamma. So we should try to sort of quantize the system in this way. So the way to do that is the following. Suppose you have this kind of time 2 plus 1 split, 1 plus 2 split, one time and two spatial direction split. Then we can write down with respect to, so suppose this is time direction, so let's choose the coordinate r over r as t. And here you have xi, where I is 1 and 2, coordinate over sigma. Then with respect to this splitting, this Chan-Simon action, which is given by this, can be written the same Chan-Simon action with using this 2 plus 1 split can be expressed in this way. Integral over time direction and integral over sigma of trace of epsilon ij ai del t of aj plus a naught times fij. So epsilon ij should go outside. Like that. You can think of this as two form over sigma, so you can integrate that over sigma. So if you look at that, this action is saying two things. First of all, this does not contain time derivative with respect to the t component of the gauge field. So a of t serves as a Lagrange multiplier. This is familiar. So for example, when we talk about geometry of the Amilsary area, there also the time component of the gauge field plays the role of Lagrange multiplier. So a t is Lagrange multiplier. And it enforces the condition that Fij is equal to zero. On the other hand, if you look at this equation, that means that Ai and Aj are canonically conjugate to each other. So that means that you would have the following commutation relation. Well, let's choose the Lie algebra G of the group G, and suppose it has an index A from 1 to the dimension of the group. I choose A as an index for the I choose some particular basis for this is a vector space, so let's choose a particular basis for that and index that with this A. Then we can have the commutation relation like this. Well, equal time to commutation relation. So Ai A of T of X, Aj of B of T of Y, it's equal time K over 2 pi I epsilon ij delta ab times delta of x minus y on this two-dimensional surface. what we are doing is that we consider gauge field on this two-dimensional surface, introduce this kind of commutation relation, enforces this commutation relation on the gauge field component, but impose the condition that this gauge field A is subject to this constraint that Fij is zero. So we can quantize this system in two different ways. One is that you consider Hilbert space to be function of functional, if you like, of this gauge connection A, but satisfying this commutation relation. So for example, you can choose one of the components to be coordinate and the other component to be conjugate momentum, which is represented as derivative with respect to that original component. But impose this as sort of operatorial equation, constraint equation on the Hilbert space. Or you can choose another point of view and say that impose this condition first. So that means that we are considering flat vector bundle over manifold, two-dimensional manifold M. This can be a useful perspective because, in fact, when two-dimensional surface sigma is, say, compact without boundary, when sigma is closed and compact, then the space of flat connection is actually finite dimensional. So then you'd be actually doing some quantization of finite dimensional system, which is actually even mathematically makes sense. So that's another way to think about this approach. And in fact, if you take that second point of view, then you can actually make sense of this Hilbert space in a more rigorous way. So this Fij is equal to zero, so you have a space of so moduli space. Of flat vector bundle. Over this surface sigma. And suppose this two-dimensional surface sigma is of genus G. Then you can actually show the following, that you can quantize M, so this is sigma. By quantize M, I mean that since we have this commutation relation, or in classical term, Poisson bracket, we can perform symplectic reduction. I told you about symplectic reduction. So suppose you have this Poisson bracket structure, and suppose you have this constraint, and in this case, this is a first-class constraint. Then you can reduce this Poisson bracket on the reduced space. So this space M is endowed with the Poisson structure inherited from this original Poisson structure. So since you have Poisson structure on M, you can quantize this space by choosing coordinate and momentum, and then you perform the standard procedure. So from this, you can define Hilbert space. There is actually a beautiful formula for the dimension of the Hilbert space. So unfortunately, I do not have time to explain the derivation of this formula. This K is, of course, K in front of this Chan-Simon action. It's rather non-trivial that this actually number turned out to be an integer. Because you have this kind of things. It is. And so this is called Fehrlinde formula. It was initially derived for different quantity, but it turned out to be turned out as an interpretation as dimension of the Hilbert space that you obtain by quantizing the moduli space of flat connection with the commutation relation which inherited from this commutation relation. So this dependence K comes from this dependence. So this is a case when the gauge group G is SU2. And there are, of course, other generalization of this formula. I'm writing this formula for the case of gauge group is SU2.
Okay? So why is this approach useful? Well, this approach is useful because this can give you another way to compute the Chan-Simon observable. And the reason for that is the following. It is known that if M is any three-dimensional manifold, there is this thing called Hegel splitting. So any three-dimensional manifold can be presented. The Hegel splitting is a statement that any three-dimensional manifold M can be represented as gluing of two Hunter bodies. So Hunter body is a following object that it is a three-dimensional manifold with boundary, and the boundary being Riemann surface of genus G. But it is inside is filled in. So for example, in the case of genus G is equal to 1, you can think of actually donut with inside filled in. Okay, so that's an example of Hunter body. Now, of course, if you have two of these, and if you glue the surface together, you get some three-dimensional space without a boundary, right? And the statement is that any three-dimensional manifold can be represented in that way. Okay? It's a rather non-trivial thing, but so let me demonstrate how this works. So, for example, suppose you have G equal 1. Okay? So it's a torus. The Hunter body in this case is a solid torus. And I'm going to denote it by T alpha beta in the following sense. So let's call this cycle alpha, and let's call its dual cycle beta. And suppose I fill inside of the donut in such a way that this alpha cycle is contractible to inside. So beta is not contractible. You can, for example, cut through this torus along beta, and then the section is just disk bounded by alpha. But you can't do that for beta. Okay? Now, I introduced this marking alpha and beta to keep track of the fact that, to keep track of which cycle is contractible and which is not. Okay? Now, so what we can say is that suppose we glue T alpha beta and T beta alpha. What would you get? Namely, suppose you glue, you take one Hunter body, in this case, solid torus, where alpha is contractible. Suppose I take another torus, where beta is contractible, and glue the surface together, so that alpha is glued with alpha and beta is glued with beta. What would you get? What the geometry you would get? exactly. That the three spheres that you get. And the way one way to think about that is a three sphere is just our familiar three-dimensional Euclidean space with infinity added to it. So suppose I consider handle body, this solid torus floating over here. Okay. So then, of course, that's a part of this space. And then you can, so alpha cycle is contractible. So in order to construct a three sphere by gluing two solid torus together, what you should envision is that first you consider one solid torus with alpha cycle contractible. You consider complement of that space. What's the rest? What is the space? What is the handle body which you can glue to that solid torus to get three sphere? In order to understand that, you just have to remove that solid torus. If you look at the complement, you can see that in the complement, beta cycle is contractible. Because beta cycle can be contracted to outside of the solid torus by definition. So therefore, if you combine these two, you get S3. So here is your small formwork exercise to show that gluing T alpha beta with the same thing gives you S1 times S2. Okay? So here is an example where the different way of gluing handle body give rise to different geometry. Okay, now, so why this has to do with quantization of a flat connection of a Riemann surface? Well, the way that it works is that suppose you have a Riemann surface, okay? So then you can put some flat connection over this Riemann surface. And then suppose you choose flat G connection, then suppose this is a handle body, well, then you have a space inside, three-dimensional space inside of it. So this is a flat A bundle AI. So then you can actually perform functional integral inside of this handle body with the Chan-Simon exponential of Chan-Simon action. This gives you some functional or function which is a function of the choice of over the space of flat connection. You get some kind of function over the space of flat connection. You can show that this is an element of this Hilbert space. So that means that for each choice of handle body, you get some special vector, special state vector for the Hilbert space of the canonical quantization of Chan-Simon theory. So canonical quantization of Chan-Simon theory has this many choice of state. For example, in the case of genus 1, where this is 1, so in the case of G equal 1, for example, for G equal 1, dimension of the Hilbert space, according to that formula right there, would be k. Because for g equal 1, this would be 1. This would be 1, but you sum this from 0 to k, so excuse me, k plus 1. So for g equal 1, you have k plus 1 dimensional vector space. For each choice of solid torus, and then suppose alpha is contractible, I'm doing functional integral, you choose particular vector out of this k plus 1 dimensional vector space. If you choose different choice, if you make different choice, you get different vector from here. So that means that if you have two handle bodies, so in this case, say, for example, T alpha beta, then it gives you some state vector parameterized by alpha beta, which is an element
of the Hilbert space for genus 1 in this case, say for example in the case of solid torus. So suppose M is given by union of two handle body like that. The functional integral over M is then given by inner product of these two elements of the Hilbert space. The reason for that is that what you do is you separate M into T alpha beta and T gamma delta glued together all over the boundary. And then what you do is first do the functional integral inside of the T alpha beta, where by definition that's going to give you gauge field, that's going to give you the state vector psi of alpha beta. You perform functional integral inside of T gamma delta, where it's going to give you this vector. But then what you remain to do is do the functional integral over gauge field configuration at the boundary. But they are glued together. And that procedure is the same as doing this inner product. So this way, if you know how to identify a state vector associated to each handle body, then computing the partial function for the Hegel splitting, so for the three-dimensional manifold presented by this Hegel splitting, is simply given by computing inner product of these two state vectors. This perspective has turned out to be extremely useful. And we can use this kind of perspective and other perspective to compute Chan-Simon partition function. So let me give you one example. So suppose we want to compute the Chan-Simon functional integral over manifold S1 times S3, S1 times S2. That is to do the functional integral over Chan-Simon action for S1 times S2. There are various ways to look at things. One way to look at it is the following, that what is S1 times S2, where you have S1, and then you have a family of S2 over there. And one way to think about that is that you think of this S1 direction as your time. And then so you have S2 periodically identified around this S1. Okay, now, if this is a standard Hamiltonian system, then you'd say that this is just equal to trace over the Hilbert space with the exponential of minus I t times the Hamiltonian. This is the Hamiltonian. Because this Hamiltonian is a time evolution operator, so you start with a particular state in this time slice t, and then you evolve the time along this circle and come back, and time evolution is generated by Hamiltonian. In the Chan-Simon theory, Hamiltonian is zero. Because what is the Hamiltonian? Well, Hamiltonian is equal to PQ dot minus Lagrangian. Lagrangian and Hamiltonians are related to each other by this relation. Lagrangian is equal to PQ dot minus Hamiltonian. But in our case, where in Chan-Simon theory, it is A A dot plus A naught times Fij, if you remember the form of Lagrangian written in this 2 plus 1 dimensional split. This is just a Lagrange multiplier, so it should be ignored. So then you only have this structure, and Hamiltonian is zero. In fact, if you do the Legendre transformation of Lagrangian, Chan-Simon Lagrangian, try to compute Hamiltonian, you find Hamiltonian to be equal to zero. In fact, it is as it should be, because this is a topological theory. And if, for example, it should not depend on the size of this S1. So therefore, it should not depend, the Hamiltonian should be zero. So that means that it is equal to 1 traced over the Hilbert space. So you can. So what you have to ask is that what is, so basically what this is asking is that what is the dimension of the Hilbert space? What is the dimension of the Hilbert space over sphere? And I erase the formula over there, but if you substitute g equals 0 in that formula, you get 1. For sphere, there is only one state, and that's actually is natural because there is no flat vector bundle over S3 except for a trivial one. So that means that the space of the moduli space of flat connection over S3 is a point. And if you quantize a point, then you only get one state. So therefore, this is 1. And this is the correct answer it turns out in this case. And if you know this one, if you know this answer, then you can also compute other partition function, which is you can obtain by Hilbert splitting. And so I would like to spend the next 10 minutes or so explaining how this works. Okay, in order to explain that, I'd like to remind you, so there is actually a deep connection between Chan-Simon gauge theory in 3 dimensions and the WZW model, Bessel-Zmino-Witten model, which is an example of conformal field theory in 2 dimensions. So I need to explain this connection. So I'd like to remind you about conformal field theory first. So in conformal field theory, which I talked about in a couple of lectures ago, I said that there is an energy momentum tensor, which plays a very important role. And so, for example, you can choose a metric of the two-dimensional surface to be like this. And the energy momentum tensor of conformal field theory has this kind of operator product expansion. And I explained that this operator product expansion is related if you expand this energy momentum tensor in mode. This operator product expansion is equivalent to the Virasoro commutation relation. So we talked about this kind of conformal field theory. This kind of structure exists for any conformal field theory, but there are particular class of conformal field theory called WZW model, which comes with an additional structure. It comes with a choice of gauge group G. And associated to the gauge group G, there is a current. So you have a gauge group G with dimension G. So suppose you have a gauge group G, then there is actually current T taking value in the adjoint representation of the gauge group. And then there is going to be an operator product expansion of this current. Like this. Where k is going to be an integer which is will turn out to be the same integer that appears in the level of the in front of the Chan-Simon action, and FABC is a structure constant of that group G. So for example, when G is SU2, you have a current taking value between 1 to 3, and then you have this operator product expansion. Which goes like this. Okay. So you get this kind of additional structure in the Hilbert space. So, for example, if you have analog of WZW Virasoro generator, you can expand this current generator in this way. And you can show that this operator product expansion is equivalent to the statement that you have this kind of commutation relation. Except there is an I here. Okay, so that means that Hilbert space of WZW model is not only representation of this, but it is also a representation of this kind of algebra. Okay? And so suppose you have this WZW model. Then there is something interesting, some interesting observation you can make that points to the connection of this WZW model to the Chan-Simon theory, which is the following. So suppose you are still considering WZW model, and suppose we are interested in computing generating function of the current operator. So J is the current operator. And suppose we consider the following generating function. Exponential integral of some source term A, and then the current J integrated over two-dimensional surface, and you exponentiate that, and well, for convenience, I put this number pi here. And evaluate that using Bessel-Zumino-Witten model functional integral. Well, this J satisfies this operator product expansion. And that fact implies some functional differential equation for this generating function. It turns out that you can prove, you can simply derive that there is this following commutation relation. So following functional differential equation that this satisfies. Let me briefly explain how this comes about. Suppose I take, for example, a variation of z with respect to az bar. This is going to bring down 1 power of j over here. This j will have operator product expansion with other j's in the exponent. For example, if I take variation of z over a, what you have is expectation value of j z of a of exponential of pi of integral of a w bar b of j w of b, something like that, right? So what this is what you get. Now, there is an operator product singularity between this z, j of z, and j of w by this formula. Now, suppose I take derivative with respect to del bar over here. Then I would be taking del bar derivative of this one. J is primarily a holomorphic object, but there is a singularity here. For example, if I take derivative of the delta function, derivative of the pole, then I should get a delta function. Probably with pi here, or something like that. So that means that in particular, that means that the del z bar of jz of a with jw of b is equal to half of k delta ab of derivative of delta function. And then you also have epsilon abc of jc of w and delta function. You can write this in this way. And so this j of b can be one of j of b in the exponent. So by using this, you can actually derive this functional derivative relation. Now, in order to establish the connection of WZW model and Chan-Simon theory, what I just have to say is this is exactly the equation that wave function of Chan-Simon theory on the Riemann surface should satisfy. And the reason for that is the following. So far, on this side of the blackboard, I've been talking about the Bessel-Zumino-Witten model, but let me get back to the Chan-Simon theory on R times sigma and perform the canonical quantization. So I remind you the action for Chan-Simon theory with this splitting, with this time and space coordinate, is given by dt of trace of epsilon ij of ai aj dot, where dot denotes a time derivative, and then there is a k over 4 pi, plus a naught times fij. Okay? There is a various way to quantize this system, but suppose I choose complex structure so that I choose complex coordinates and z and z bar. Then I can also write this term using complex coordinate as trace of az, 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 az bar dot plus at of f of zz bar. You can also write it in this way. And then you can decide that az and az bar are canonically conjugate to each other. that you say that the commutation relation should be that this is equal to 2 pi I, 2 pi k of delta AB, delta of Z minus W squared. That is to say that you can choose to call your wave function as a function R of AZ bar, and then you just declare that AZ acting on it is according, in order to satisfy this commutation relation, AZ acting on it is just a functional derivative operator. You make this identification, then this commutation relation is satisfied. Now, what I have to say is that, well, we have this Lagrange multiplier term, so we have to impose fzz bar is equal to zero. But now, fzz bar equal to zero is a functional differential equation, because what this fzz bar? Well, this is equal to del z az bar minus del z bar of az plus commutation relation az az bar. But az is a derivative of az bar, so this is equal to del z of az bar. But now I have a 1 over k, so let's first multiply k to everything. So then, it's nicer because we have k times del z of az bar, but k times az is derivative with respect to az bar, so we can write this as minus of del z bar of del of az bar, and this term here is commutator of az bar and the derivative of az bar. So now this is a functional derivative operator with respect to az bar. Okay? I hope it's clear. This is very straightforward. I'm starting with this Chan-Simon action with this 2 plus 1 dimensional split, performing canonical quantization, and then decide that az bar is my coordinate, and az is its conjugate momentum represented as a derivative operator. And I'm just writing this constraint that fzz bar is equal to zero, and then discover that this functional derivative operator acting on this psi has to vanish. Go back to Lagrange, Bessel-Zmino-Witten model, and discover that this is exactly that equation. So therefore, there is this clear connection between the Hilbert space of the Chan-Simon theory, in particular, state vector of the Chan-Simon theory, and the partition function of the WZW model as a generating function for given source, with source being the connection on the two-dimensional Riemann surface. Okay, so we can actually use this connection in a very sort of powerful way, because there are so much known about WZW model. For example, what is the space of solution to this kind of differential equation? And in fact, this was originally how Fehrinde formula was derived, that Fehrinde knew how many states, or what it is called, conformal blocks, basically the sort of basic ingredient to construct the partition function of Bessel-Zmino-Witten model. So he knew how to sort of control the number of these ingredients. And for each one of them, you can construct state in the Hilbert space. So that was how one arrived at the Fehrinde formula. And so you can translate, therefore, so the way that it works is that you suppose you want to compute Chan-Simon partition function on a given three manifold. One way of doing that is to perform the Hegel splitting, construct three manifolds as gluing of two handle bodies. Each handle body, you have associated element of the wave function for the canonical quantization of Chan-Simons theory. And then you can use that connection to translate the computation of Chan-Simons partial function to some computation in the WZW model. You can also do similar computation for knot. So suppose we have some complicated knot in three dimension. You can always represent this knot by separating that into a half, cutting that into a half, and relate that to computation of the Bessel-Zumino-Witten model over this cross section with now operators inserted for each intersection of this knot with the surface. So unfortunately, I do not have time anymore to get into detail of how this works, but there is actually a very powerful way of using this kind of construction to compute the partial function of Chan-Simons theory. And this is a very mysterious connection because Chan-Simons theory is in three dimension. Bessel-Zumino-Witten model is in two dimension. Chan-Simons theory does not require metric to write down. It's a topological theory. Bessel-Zumino-Witten model does require a choice of metric. In the case of two dimension, it just, since we are talking about conformal field theory, it just boils down to the choice of complex structure of Riemann surface, but you do need the data of complex structure. You don't need that data for Bessel-Zumino-Chan-Simons theory. So these two models are seemingly different. They are in different dimensions, but somehow closely related to each other. This, in fact, is a prototype of what is called ADS-CFT correspondence, where conformal field theory in lower dimension is related to gravity theory in one higher dimension. So this is sort of prototype because Bessel-Zumino-Witten model is clearly an example of conformal field theory. And topological Chan-Simons theory is an example of one higher dimensional theory, which is general covariant. So this is also a sort of very simple example of ADS-CFT correspondence. So of course there are a lot more to talk about, but time is limited and I have just run out of time. Actually, I went over 5 more minutes, and I apologize. So I should end here. So thank you very much for joining this ride, and I hope you enjoyed it.